Hello, and welcome back. So what I want to do today is continue looking at ways in which you can split your load over multiple transistors, but rather than looking at driving transistors in parallel, like I did in the last two episodes, today I want to look at driving transistors in series. Now, this sort of circuit arrangement can have certain advantages, but also some disadvantages. So if you're curious about what sort of circuit arrangements can be achieved and what are their functional particularities, then keep watching. So let's start things off by clearly defining just what exactly we're trying to achieve by these various methods. So previously, what we were trying to achieve was to take the power dissipated on a single transistor or switching element and split it up over multiple elements to reduce the individual power dissipation. And one way of doing that is to take the current that goes through the circuit and split it up onto multiple branches, but keep the voltage on each of these branches equal. What you end up with is a way in which the power gets split up by the number of elements, but the total power dissipation is exactly the same as before. Now, with the series circuit, we get exactly the same thing. But rather than splitting up the current, we split up the voltage. So all of the elements see the exact same current, but they only see a portion of the voltage. The end result being, of course, that the power gets split up onto the multiple elements, but the total power is exactly the same as before. Now, one of the things that's worth mentioning about the two arrangements is that when we're talking about currents, especially in the modern days, getting a high current transistor is not that difficult. So usually you can get very high current capable transistors. So the only reason why you're doing this splitting up thing is to distribute the power, not really the current. On the other hand, when we talk about high voltage transistors, although you can get high voltage components, so you can get quite small transistors that go up into the kilovolt range, working with high voltages brings a few safety related topics into mind. So even though you can get quite cheap high voltage transistors, getting transistors that can be operated in a safe way at high voltages, especially in highly unforgiving environments, is not that easy. What I'm talking about, of course, is keeping safe clearance and creepage distances. To show you an example, I will be referring to a ceramic disc capacitor. So the clearance distance refers to the shortest path between exposed conductors through air, whereas creepage distance refers to the shortest distance between terminals over a solid surface. The reason why these two topics are treated differently is that over a solid surface, even though usually you have longer distances, you can also have dust buildup or all sorts of other contaminants that can create a conductive path. And for that reason, usually the requirements for creepage distance are stricter than the requirements for clearance distance. And depending on what sort of standard you're trying to adhere to and what sort of environment your circuit is being designed for, you can have some really, really strict and difficult to achieve distances to keep the circuit safe. This is why if you take apart an AC adapter, you'll see quite large distances between primary and secondary side, but also on the primary between various circuits. And especially for increasing creepage distance, you will see this sort of cuts in the PCB. So now coming back to transistors, you can get high voltage transistors, quite small in package, but using this sort of transistor, although cheap, is not really going to ensure large clearance and creepage distances. You can alternatively go for larger case sizes, which are usually far more expensive, or you can try to put multiple elements in series and simply split up the voltages. Now, I found two main ways of achieving this. So we got these two circuits, let's take them one by one. On the one side, I'm using three transistors all linked in series, but the bases are driven from a voltage divider that is connected to the upper collector, while the lower transistor is still driven by the initial input signal. And on the right side, quite a similar story. We have the three transistors in series, but the bases are driven from resistor dividers that are driven from the supply voltage directly. So in both cases, the resistor dividers are providing 1/3 and 2/3 of a supply voltage, but you can build the circuit with however many transistors you want. So here I have three, but it can be 2 or 4 or whatever number. Now, the circuit on the right might seem a bit more familiar as the cascode. It's similar. So what's the difference between the two? Well, let's simulate and find out. So the first thing, the input signal that I'm using goes from 0.4 up to 1 volt, stays there, then goes down. The main reason being that I wanted to show the circuit operating in the three main operating modes of the transistors. So with very low voltage, it's in cutoff mode, no current should be passing. With very high voltage, it's in saturation, so it should have a very small voltage drop. And then in the middle, it's in the linear operating region. So now if we look at our first circuit, we can see that it goes from around 10 volts up to 87. So it doesn't really saturate and it doesn't really open completely. So there's always some sort of current going through it. Now with the circuit on the right, we see that it's working much better. So it does go to the full 90 volts of supply and it does fall to zero, or at least very close. So why do we have the different behaviors? Well, if we start with the circuit on the left, when the transistor should be in cutoff mode, so no current passing through the transistor, well, there's no current passing through the lower one, nothing through the collector of the upper one or the other one, but between the load and the ground, we still have this resistor divider. So even if there's no current passing through the transistors, you still have a voltage divider created between the load and the base resistors that is limiting your upper voltage. On the other side, when you're trying to saturate the circuit, so if the collector voltage would be very small, then there would be nothing to drive the bases. So for the circuit to actually work, you need the base of the second transistor to be about 0.7 volts above its emitter, but you also need a current, so you have some sort of voltage drop on the middle resistor. Then on the upper transistor, again, you need a certain base voltage and a certain base current, so both of these currents will be passing through the upmost resistor, and you end up with 10 volts of voltage drop on the thing. With the other circuit, things are a bit different. Because resistor dividers are no longer supplied from a variable voltage, they're always supplied from the supply voltage, you can easily saturate all of the transistors because there's always something to drive the base with. So if we come back to the simulations again, and we look at the voltages that drop on the transistors, we can see that during saturation, we have a very, very small drop on all three of the transistors on the circuit on the right side. At the same time, when we're in cutoff, when there's no current passing through the transistors, we have roughly equal voltages on all of them. And regarding cutoff, there's another important thing to mention. The right side circuit can achieve the supply voltage in the collector because there's nothing else to conduct the voltage between the collector and emitter like we had on the left side. Now, looking at the voltage drops on the three transistors, we can see that although they all go from 0 to roughly 30 volts, so 1/3 of the supply voltage in this case, they don't rise at the same time. So we can see that with green, the first transistor starts to have a voltage drop on it, then with blue, the second transistor, then with red, the third transistor. So the three transistors, although you have the same current going through them, the voltage drop on them goes in steps. So depending on what sort of voltage you're supposed to be getting in the collector, one or more of the transistors is handling this voltage drop. On the right side, however, again, if we look at the voltage drops on the various transistors, we see a slightly different story. So when in cutoff, all of them have roughly the same voltage drop. When saturating, well, one saturates and the others don't, but this is something we expected. But in the linear region, all the transistors have roughly the same voltage drop on them. That's because the base voltages are all proportional to the collector voltage. And the final outcome of the two behaviors, if we now look at the power dissipations, on the left side, we can see that, well, during saturation, we have different power dissipations because, well, we have different voltage drops. But during the linear region, the power dissipations on all of the transistors are roughly equal. Now, if we look at the circuit on the right side though, we see a slightly different story. So we have low power dissipation both in saturation and in cutoff, because the transistors are actually turning off and actually turning on. But during the linear region, we see again the power dissipation increasing in steps. So at one point, only one of the transistors has power dissipation on it while all the other ones are saturated. Then another transistor starts to take up part of the slack, and then the third transistor. So in the end, all of the transistors at full power have power dissipation on present on them. But before that, the power is split onto transistors in steps. So both of these circuits achieve the goal of splitting up the voltage present on the transistors. None of the transistors will see more than the supply voltage divided by however number of transistors are present. And they both sort of achieve the goal of splitting the power, in that with the first circuit we actually have power split up evenly, but with the second circuit it's split up only under certain conditions. Now, another thing to mention about this circuit is how it behaves with faster signals. So we started off with a 1 millisecond rise and fall time, but if I take the exact same circuits with 1 nanosecond rise and fall times and we look at the various voltages, so I'll be looking at the voltage drop on each of the transistors, we see with the left side circuit that we have some spikes appearing, and with the right side circuit it's exactly the same thing, only it's worse this time. So after a certain amount of time, the voltages are split up nice and evenly. But right when the transition is happening, so if you're trying to use this as a switch, then you have these spikes appearing because the voltages are no longer spread out equally between the transistors. Main problem here being that the various resistors present in the circuit, coupled with the various capacitances of the transistors, are causing the base voltages to vary at unequal rates. So we end up seeing some transistors turning on faster, some slower. So we get these voltage discrepancies. Now, if you're actually using the transistor at the voltage limit, then this sort of thing can destroy the transistor. If you're just using the transistor to split the power, then this should not be of much concern. But in any case, we can go around this problem by adding some capacitors. So to improve the transient response, you can add a set of capacitors in parallel with the resistors for the first circuit, and this will help with evening out the voltages during fast transients. And for the second circuit, I have the same capacitors connected between the collector and the emitter and then the bases, other than the resistors. So if we run the two circuits like this with the same input pulse and we look at the various voltage drops on the collector emitters, we can see for the left side circuit that things are looking much better. We still have a small spike, but this can be corrected with larger capacitor values. And for the circuit on the right side, similar story. Circuit is working much better, still a small spike, but it's manageable this time. Now, we can also build similar circuits with field effect transistors, but we need to take into account certain precautions. So what I got here is the two types of circuits built with field effect transistors, same resistor dividers, same capacitors, only this time I'm using much larger values because the field effect transistors don't really need current to be driven, so we can work with large resistors this time. But I also added some protection components because of the special requirements of this type of transistor. So on the one side we have zener diodes between the gate and the source to prevent excess voltage forming in the gate, and also series resistors with the gates to prevent oscillations. And these are present in both circuits. So if we run these two, we see a similar behavior to what we've seen before. So the circuit with the series resistors doesn't really saturate because of the voltages needed to drive the transistors, but because of the larger resistor values, when it's in an open circuit, it's much closer to the supply voltage because there's far smaller currents running through the resistors. With the circuit on the right, it's a bit better because the transistors actually saturate and actually go into an open mode. Now, if we look at the various voltage drops on each of the transistors, we still see some spikes appearing, and the transistors aren't switching very fast because of the large capacitors added. This can be corrected with smaller capacitors, but you will also need transistors with smaller internal capacitances. If we look to the circuit on the right side, similar story. Because of the large capacitors needed, the circuit is still having certain voltage inequalities, but it's working. So now we've seen how this sort of circuit should be looking in a simulator. Let's see how it should look and how it actually works in real life. So to try things out, I prepared a setup. So what I got here is my high voltage power supply. So in my test circuits, I will be using 45 volt rated transistors, but I will be supplying the circuit from a far higher voltage so that in case the transistors are not really supplied correctly, then they will tell us using some smoke signals. And to perform the actual measurements, rather than relying on voltmeters, today I'll be using the oscilloscope, and both channels are being used together with the math function that is showing us the difference between the two. So this way you can measure the voltage drop on each of the transistors while applying a dynamic input signal. Speaking of the input signal, I'll be using a triangle wave that will get the transistors through the three operating modes. So let's start things off with the first circuit. Both my circuits are on the same board, but the first circuit is the one on the left. This one has three transistors, and the bases of the upper two are supplied from the two resistor dividers, and then we also have the capacitors in place. So let's see what happens. If we look on the voltage drop in the first collector, we can see that it's roughly 20 something volts plus the spike. So my oscilloscope channels are set to 20 volts per division, but the math channel is set to 10 volts per division. That's why they look a bit different. If we look on the second transistor, again, we see roughly 30 volts dropping on it. And if we look on the third transistor, again, roughly 30 volts. Now, another thing we can observe is that each of the transistors starts conducting at a certain point in the signal. So right now, if I can click the single button, we can see that the other transistors are conducting, but then the voltage drop on the third transistor only happens in this upper part of the signal. And in the same way, we can see the voltage drop on the other transistors. So this is showing us the step-by-step mechanism through which each of the transistors is conducting. So for example, this is with blue, the final collector voltage. This is the intermediate collector and then the lower collector. So we can see all three of the transistors working one after the other, not at the same time. So now let's switch to the other board. So I'm using the same setup as before, the same supply voltage. Now if we look at the transistors here, so first of all, if we analyze the final collector voltage, we can see that it doesn't really go down to zero, so we do have a certain voltage drop when we're trying to saturate the transistor, so it's not properly saturating. And if we now look at the individual voltages on each of the three transistors, so this is the first transistor, second transistor, and third transistor. So we can see that the signals are far more balanced in the sense that all of the voltage drops on the transistors are roughly equal. So this circuit is doing a far better job at splitting up the voltages without any spikes. But we can also see that the transistors are each taking up voltage at the same time. So here we can see the final collector and the lower collector, and the voltage drops are never the same. So the voltages are increasing proportionally and equally. So all three of the transistors are taking up the dissipated power roughly in an equal fashion. So all in all, depending on what you're trying to build, in certain cases, this might be the right answer for your application. It's not a very common circuit, but it is found in certain high voltage applications or whenever you want to split up the power using series connected elements. So all in all, hope you got some useful information out of this. Leave your thoughts in the comments. Thank you for watching. Make sure to subscribe to be up to date with all my latest videos, and see you next time. Bye bye.